when we're thinking about the legacy of President Carter and Rosalynn Carter, there was a part, and it came up yesterday, not a small amount, that's actually very, very important to, coincidentally, the way in which the field evolved. And you heard from the previous panel and the directors that the field evolved in a way that in some ways resembles the ever-expanding universe theories that we have now that are actually out of control. We have a situation here where we thought the world was 13 billion years, and it turns out it's still accelerating in ways that don't make sense from laws of physics. So there's this notion of ever-expansion. And that's exactly the trajectory that happened with the school, because it began with really interesting theoreticians and practitioners who had their own, each practitioner has their own theory, whether they've written books or not. And there were practitioners, and then there were theoreticians that were coming off of a more universalist approach to the human being. And one of the reasons why the clash was inevitable between culture and identity-based approaches and universal approaches that John Burton had was that it's difficult. We consist of both high similarities to all humans, and we also have these unique spaces of our identity, of our culture, and my job was to fill in the complexity of that and start even more conflicts about religion. And so my vocation, I wouldn't call it a profession, my obsession for the last 40 years was the subject of religion. And I brought to this the question when I came in 2003, the deeper analysis of the ways in which religion is weaponized for violence and the ways in which it contributes to peacemaking. And that turns out to be a universal pattern in all major religions in all parts of the world. It is both, and now it's referred to sometimes as political religion and personal religion. And the political religion tends to create a great deal of intolerance. It actually has highly secular roots of power, interests, and control, which are proto-violent. And then personal religion is as varied as the people who have it, and therefore often come with a deep attachment to emotional and spiritual values that motivate their lives, that propel their lives. Those motivations can be the love of all human beings, love your neighbor as yourself. Those motivations can be the dignity of all human beings. It can be compassion. And we knew that the Carter legacy, and we've known that the Carter legacy has that piece of it. And yet, the kind of spirituality that Jimmy Carter brought to his life and his mission seemed distinctly different from a weaponized form of the religion that would especially later explode into American politics and into the terrible divides we have now, but the terrible divides that are highly destructive in the Middle East and elsewhere with the radicalization and politicization of religion. So this complexity of legacy is something that these panelists have been working on their entire lives. They don't actually know each other. I know all of them. And I brought them together because of the unique creativity and genius of each in their own worlds. And I wanted us to discuss, and I was asked to have us discuss the legacy of Jimmy Carter in the context of this question of when religion is redemptive and when it is a problem, and what do we learn from Jimmy's contribution to that, from Jimmy and Rosalynn's contribution as figures. So yesterday, well, I'll get into yesterday for a second, and then I'll introduce, we'll go in order with your reflections on that, and then we'll have Q&A with each other and then with the audience. So I called this session the Nexus of Humanitarian Service, Policy, Religious Practice, and Education by Example, the Jimmy Carter Legacy. It's as long as all the titles in my books, which is, you know, there's the power of the word, you know, in the beginning was the word. In the beginning, there was the excessive word in academia, right? And so I have a tendency to not be, so I apologize for the length of that title, but it sort of includes a lot of the things we're thinking about, namely humanitarian service policy, actually, the translation of that into policy, religious practice, serious religious practice, and we can indulge in that in this panel, and education by example. You know, the way in which our field, our work in religion, has cut through all of the complexity right towards personal practice, personal symbols of a very deep way. And so I'll just say one of the reasons I'm in this field to you folks, and by way of example here today, is that I kind of revered the field of conflict resolution before I came into it. I revered it because I was disappointed with the collapse of ethical consensus in Western culture and the collapse of the ability of the field of ethics to actually get down to reality and actually help with practice and with real people. So I launched into this field and I studied everybody, many of whom were up on this panel before. I studied all of them. And then at the same time, I was looking for the simplicity of the spiritual geniuses that we all know who made history. And some of them are famous, some of them will never be known because of the spiritual gestures that they made that moved hearts, sometimes a few hearts, sometimes millions. So for me, I catapulted into this field. One of the reasons is because one of the people at Camp David, who I got close to, told me his version. Yesterday, we had a little bit different version of the moment at which Menachem Begin changed his heart. Because as we heard yesterday, they many times both were going to leave. And they were kept apart and so on. And I knew, I studied this very carefully, because now since then I've written a lot of books on psychosocial neuroscience. That's my focus, is how the person gets through. And Jimmy had this sense about Sadat, and they had a closeness that was extraordinary. There's a valiant warrior and a valiant peacemaker who would then pay for it with his life. But we had a tough time with Begin, because Begin had engaged in terrorism, serious terrorism in the 1930s. And he was not easy. And yet at the same time, those who knew the stories, and Jimmy did incredible homework on people, knew that he had a passion for family and for children. For children. This was a man whose father was killed with 5,000 other people by the side of a river on the border of Belarus and Poland in 1945. 5,000 people at once with his father. The rest of his family was also killed in other places in Europe. So he comes to this, his Zionism, his nationalism, his Judaism, with a determination that he's going to protect every life no matter what it takes. And Jimmy knew that's what he was dealing with. So brilliantly, somebody said to Sadat and Begin before they came, bring pictures of your grandchildren. They brought children of the grandchildren. They brought pictures of the grandchildren. Mm-hmm. And I know mediators who do the same thing now in mediation, which is a very interesting model. And they brought them, and then it was failing as a negotiation. And they each had a cabin, and they were separated. And he comes to the cabin of Begin, and Jimmy hands him the pictures. I wanted you to know, here's the pictures of all the grandchildren, mine, yours, and Anwar Sadat's. Before you go, because he was going to leave. He looked at the pictures, and he looked up at the sky, according to my friend. He started to cry. And he said, let's try again. So you see, this is the power that we know, we've seen. And so I'd like to start with you, Julie. This is Reverend, I'm sorry, I don't have paper. This is the extraordinary Reverend Julie Pennington Russell, who's the senior pastor at the First Baptist Church of the city of Washington, D.C., introduced to me and my wife, Crystal, through Charlie Reynolds, Reverend Charlie Reynolds, who was known as Charlie Chaplin in the military for extraordinary work that he did, interfaith work in the field under fire all across the world in conflict zones in his career in the military as a chaplain. And so we came to the service and we sensed the connection with you. And I know that because of the spiritual tradition you come from, I wanted you to be the first to comment on what is your understanding of Mr. Carter and the spiritual tradition that you come from. And I'd like to start with that, and then we'll move on to Reverend Rodney.
Well, that's such a wonderful question. And I would describe, so let me say this first. Jimmy Carter joined First Baptist Church along with Rosalynn and their son Chip and Chip's wife Karen, their daughter Amy, on the very first Sunday of his presidency. And they came as a family. Amy was baptized 2 weeks later. Of the 48 weeks of his presidency, Jimmy Carter was participating in worship at least 75 times. So he was very, very present. He taught a Sunday school class, like he does in Plains. Almost immediately, he began to teach, and he taught probably about 14 times during his presidency. And at one point during a dinner that the Sunday school class had, he just told them, he said, "You have made our lives normal lives." He said, "You," and he was really speaking about the congregation, he said, "You have given stability to us in what is inherently an unstable kind of job." And he said, so he blessed the congregation for that. And I think, as Suzanne pointed out this morning, community was very, very important to the Carters. And so immediately upon arriving in Washington, they surrounded themselves with Christian community. To your point, we have recordings of all of the Bible studies that President Carter taught. And here's what I would say. On the Sunday after the signing of the Camp David Peace Accords, it was just 7 days later, Jimmy Carter taught a Sunday school class, and he was teaching. It was it was something about conflict. I'm blanking on it now. But it was about conflict from the book of Philippians. And what he said then was that the time at Camp David had been one of the most difficult times of his life, but also one of the most joyful times of his life. And what made it joyful for him was coming into contact with two leaders who were very, very devout, very deep in their faith. He said they prayed throughout the entire time at Camp David. He said Jimmy Carter would pray with them separately. He would pray with Menachem Begin. He would pray with Anwar Sadat. And he said what was so meaningful to me was that we all agreed that we all worship the same God. And I say that to say, when you were talking about the difference between weaponized religion and a broad religion, Jimmy Carter, 50 years ago, had a very broad religion, and he was a Baptist. He was, in fact, during his presidency, a Southern Baptist. And yet he acknowledged that they, as children of the Abrahamic faith, all worship the same God. He said that to Anwar. He said that to Menachem. And I think that made a real difference there, the broadness, the breadth of his faith.
That's much more than I expected. I didn't even know of the connection to your church. I was thinking of your spiritual legacy and the great work that you've done, and I didn't even know that they actually, it's incredible. Wonderful, wonderful synergy. I want to introduce now the wonderful Reverend Rodney Sadler, who's on the faculty of the Union Presbyterian Seminary. But much, much larger than that is that Reverend Rodney has been a pioneer for his life in interfaith work, civil rights work, ecumenical work for the sake of social justice and social change. And I've come to admire and revere his spiritual strength in the face of so many different challenges that we've had, especially I got to know you in the last 5 years of the difficult years since 2016. Online, you know, most of our relationship was completely online in the COVID years. And so I'd like you to share what your thoughts are about Jimmy Carter, his Christian faith, how it expressed itself in terms of the work that we do in peace building and social change.
Well, thank you. And it's wonderful to be here, Mark. Thank you so much for having me. And it's wonderful to be able to be here and talk about Jimmy Carter. I do not know Jimmy Carter. I did not pastor a church where he is. I've known Jimmy Carter mostly from a great distance all of my life, and have had the deepest admiration for him as a president, as a Christian, and as a human being. I often make the comment, you know, I'm a black guy, so Barack Obama is my favorite president. No, okay, hands down. But Jimmy Carter is, I think, the best human being who's ever been president. And when I think about why I believe that is because he's a person that seems to sincerely live out his faith. The words that are on the pages of Scripture seem to be manifest in the way that he lives his life, in the things that he does, in the choices that he makes, difficult choices. I remember when I was at Howard University many years ago, I studied with James Carter, who apparently worked with Jimmy Carter years ago, a class on presidential politics. And he talked about the way that Jimmy Carter would, he called him a micromanager, but every decision that was made under his administration, he had something to do with, that he thought about it, he processed it, he considered it from not just a what's politically expedient, but what's morally prudent. And how do we come to a place where we can make those kinds of decisions? And that this was what's behind the whole Camp David Accords. It's that there's something greater at stake than just the exigencies of the moment. There's something greater at stake. So again, I've only met him one time in my entire life. I think that was when he put out, was it Palestine, Apartheid, or Peace? I remember just shaking his hand and melting, just because I was finally in the presence of this incredible human being, and thinking that he had, in the midst of a difficult time period, think about the conflict between Israel and Egypt at the time, he had the audacity to believe that a conflict everyone said can't be resolved could be resolved. He, for me, embodies what does it mean to envision that which seems impossible and to work for it until it becomes reality. I think that's the kind of courage and leadership that we often see lacking. I think far too often we govern toward the impossible, and we limit what is possible because of the closeness of our imagination. So I think that he for me represents an exemplar of what it means to strive for the ideal and work towards it and manifest it. In terms of a Christian, I was talking to someone the other day about the way that he was perceived by his Southern Baptist constituents. I think they said something about them excommunicating it. Hard to believe you'd excommunicate Jimmy Carter, of all people, because he does not line up with doctrine that they hold dear. Baptist and doctrine, we don't really have much of that anyway. But this notion that we can define Christianity in very narrow ways, and you just were alluding to this a second ago when you were talking about his ability to see the oneness of God, Shema Yisrael Adonai Eloheinu Adonai Echad, the oneness of God in three different religions, and to venerate that which is manifest in the face of an enemy, Sadat, Meghan, all of us are viewing the same God. That's the kind of Christianity I want to embody. A Christianity that does not limit my understanding of humanity and divinity, but that expands it. So I think, for me, I think Jimmy Carter is a person that has actualized the way that faith engages life and the way that life engages the world and the way, and in terms of just a leader, the way that a leader should lead from the soul.
Thank you. Thank you. I just want to get everybody in because we have very brief amount of time, and I want to go to Professor Catherine Marshall, Senior Fellow, Berkeley Center for Religion, Peace, and World Affairs at Georgetown University, but that doesn't capture the fact that Catherine has been a pioneer of international development, women, and an extraordinary high-level interfaith work that was designed to change the nature of development and peace building at the highest levels that would fund and create what we do. And Catherine has been a mentor and a friend, and I'm in awe of your deep comfort, your awareness of, your participation in presidential families of this country and your deep roots here. And I just would love your insights, especially because you've known so much of presidential personalities over history, and you also yourself have pioneered as part of those communities. What are your thoughts on what he pulled off, and where religion and spirituality fits into that?
Well, as I read the title of this panel, apart from being a little dizzy, I was very struck by a theme that we're so focused on now, which is interconnected, or I would say intertwined. But even looking back, because I have a long history of this, working mostly on international development, and then with this question of what's religion got to do with it. But thinking how we saw things so separately 50 odd years ago. You know, in international development, if you couldn't visit someplace, you didn't fund it, so you didn't go to conflict areas. There was even a time when health was seen as, and education were seen as, really not part of development. Religion was simply not there. And we have come now to a time when we're almost bewildered ourselves by trying to figure out how to navigate in a situation where everything is connected to something else and everyone is connected, sort of the global and, as I think you referred to, also the very personal. How do you navigate the difference between the very strong common elements and the diversity? I think I have had sporadic, far too few contacts with the Carters, but some at least over the years. And I do see them as pressing us really forward on this sense of cutting through the silos, the professional silos and the personal silos, so that river blindness, for example, or guinea worm, these diseases were seen as so much tied to human rights and tied to the economy, but also to the culture and the spirit of the people. The idea that you really did look to the end of the road, the diseases that affected people in the far realms. We worked quite a bit at one point with Habitat for Humanity as it was reflecting after, I think, 40 years on its spiritual foundations and how they had changed over the years. But the Habitat for Humanity, which at, and the time I last looked at it was really mobilizing over 1 million volunteers a year, but obviously with the Carter inspiration. But it was very much the theology of the hammer and the idea that if you work together, you can overcome the differences. You can find the common humanity. And that, I think, is a very powerful sense that exemplifies at least a part of the Carter spirit. I think the other thing that I haven't heard mentioned in the short time that I could be here is the unequivocal focus on human rights as a foundation. We're at a time now where there's far too much debate about human rights, I think, and what is a human right? And of course, we all know that human rights also mean human responsibility, and we know the history of human rights, that the traditions that it came out of and the traditions that it didn't come out of. And I think we need to continue wrestling with that. But that was so much a centerpiece of his presidency, of really trying, and it's at a time when we're struggling so much with what are American values and what is it that this country and our history and our present stand for, and how do we wrestle with those complex questions with the kind of depth, which I think is part of this question of the interconnectedness, is how do you see the connections at the same time that you go sufficiently into the depth. I have a lot of other things that I was going to raise, but maybe I won't now because we do have so little time.
Yeah, it's very packed day. So I just want to get to everybody before we open it up to follow up. Rabbi Gerald Serrata, Executive Director Emeritus of the Interfaith Council of Metropolitan Washington. That doesn't do justice to at least 50 years that Jerry has been a pioneer of social justice work across the world, in the United States and in the Middle East and in Israel-Palestine. He's one of the pioneers at great personal risk and sacrifice of standing up for Palestinian rights way, way back already in the 1970s or 1980s. And he's a dear, dear friend. What do you relate to in the Carter legacy? What are the nexus points between you and this legacy?
Well, thank you for the opportunity to escape the TV and the internet and this. It's a very challenging time for the legacy of Jimmy Carter. He did more than any president to attempt to bring together Israelis and Palestinians and others in the Middle East as a president and post-president. I had brought with me a prayer of the mothers of Israeli mother, written by an Israeli mother and a Palestinian mother. If there's time, I may conclude with that, but I did want to use a text today that I thought exemplified the President Carter's roots and his faith and his hopes, both of which are important in the conversation that we're having now. A very wise British rabbi named Jonathan Sacks gave a very clear definition of faith and of hope that I think is a good starting point for understanding or reflecting on Jimmy and Rosalynn Carter. Rabbi Sacks said, "Faith is not acceptance but protest against the world that is and in the name of the world that is not yet but ought to be. Faith lies not in the answer but the question. The greater the human being, the more intense the question. To ask is to believe that somewhere there is an answer." And then the contrast between optimism and hope that he discussed as well. Optimism is the belief that the world is changing for the better. Hope is the belief that together we can make the world better. Optimism is a passive virtue, hope an active one. It needs no courage to be an optimist, but it takes a great deal of courage to hope. The Hebrew Bible is not an optimistic book. It is, however, one of the great literatures of hope. And that's what I encountered in President Carter, in his writing and his living and what he stands for now. I only met him once in my life. We happened to be on the same plane. I don't remember where we were going, but he was, of course, sitting in the economy section in the middle seat by himself. And that says something about President Carter. And I went over to thank him, said I was a rabbi, and this was during the controversy around his book, and he thanked me. But I did have two other, in my life, important events, but trivial in the scope of what we're talking about. For my 60th birthday, which wasn't yesterday, I decided that the best way to have a birthday was to sponsor a Habitat for Humanity build. And that's what we did. And it was the best birthday I ever had. And I learned a couple of things from that that surprised me. One is how hard it is to work even for a few hours painting, which was probably the easiest thing to do. But to do that for 6, 7, 8 hours, even with a break, is not easy. And I thought about the President Carter, then much older than I, was still doing this on a regular basis. So I learned some respect for working people that I hadn't, people work with their hands. Also had the experience when we went to a Subway to get sandwiches, vegetarian sandwiches for everybody working on my, on the build on my birthday. I explained to the people at the Subway what we were doing, and they gave us a whole big thing of cookies, this religious example just spread to everybody who attended, how one should celebrate, how one should be in the world. And it created waves of generosity that I was lucky to enjoy. The other time I mentioned to Catherine, it happened that when Palestine Peace, Not Apartheid was published in 2006, the title made the book very unpopular in the Jewish community, maybe other places, but as a consequence, 12 Jewish members of the board of the they devised, not the real board, but just a collection of people whose names had been, they resigned. And the rabbinical conference was supposed to be held in Atlanta that year, and a visit to the Carter Center was going to be one of the options on an open afternoon, and they canceled the this visit right after this resignation. I wasn't planning to go to this conference, but for that reason, I said, I'm going to that conference, and I'm going to announce the people there that we're going to the Carter Center the next day. And 25 of us did, which is probably more than would have chosen to go had they stupidly made this decision. And it was an interesting experience. We were met by leader there. I think his name was Nathan Hodes. Last name was definitely Hodes. And we asked why this book is still an important book and a thoughtful book up to the 2006. Did he have any other thoughts about the title, since it prevented people, some of us thought, from reading the book and learning from it? Dr. Hodes said that he wrote the entire book himself, he chose a title. And the title was, I think, prophetic and important. And if people had been awakened by it then, we might not be where this very sad situation we're in today. The other thing, there was one sentence in that book that was particularly inflammatory, and that's what got him into trouble, which seemed to imply that if the Palestinians were somehow the oppression and the occupation justified terror and violence. And the sentence was very poorly constructed. And when pointed out to President Carter that this sentence is, it's wrong, he said, "You're absolutely right. I made a terrible mistake, and I'm the next edition, if there is a next edition, that sentence is going to be removed," which was another religious value. I don't think he was the most humble of servants, but there was a humility and an ability to say that he was wrong, which is a very important personal and religious value. The other thing that I would have mentioned is precisely what Catherine ended with. Those who know American politics know that the whole introduction of human rights into American policy is the result of Jimmy Carter. I mean, the Undersecretary for Human Rights or whatever position in the State Department is his innovation. The fact that when President Biden goes tomorrow and expresses whatever he's going to express in solidarity with the Israeli people, that he will bring up the human rights of Palestinians in Gaza and in the West Bank is a legacy of President Carter, and it's a religious legacy. We happen to read in our scriptures in the cycle the story of the creation of the first human beings, human family. We read it last week and we read it this week because the next original family is Noah and Nama. Everybody knows Adam and Eve, but we sometimes forget that we're all in this spaceship Earth, this large ark, and we're all of one human family. And that biblical teaching is what motivated, I think, President Carter, and all of you have said it in different ways, in acceptance of the many paths to the one God. So those are my personal encounters with him. He was a tremendous influence on me. If I had to, my one other personal story happened to be at an opera with Ruth Bader Ginsburg, my wife and I, in the Santa Fe a couple of years ago, and called my son, one of our sons, very excitedly. We were with Ruth Bader Ginsburg at the, and he said, he's about 30 years old at the time, said, "You were with the greatest living American." I thought to myself, who's the greatest living American? I can't even imagine such a concept. Only a young person could say that. And I said, I told them, "Zach, who?" Because the person I thought of was Jimmy Carter. But it took me a while. I said, who else would you have said was the, I mean, I did the whole thing took me weeks before I could approach it. He said, "John Lewis." Mm-hmm. So those are the three greatest living Americans at that time.
Well, this is wonderful. We're going to open it up soon to some thoughts from brief questions from the audience. But I want to highlight also, you all, I've learned so much and I didn't even know all the connections. It was just, I just had some sort of hope or faith that this was going to work out. And, but I want to highlight something that Catherine said that was very interesting is the phrase theology of the hammer. I've never heard that before. It's very powerful, but it also is an important critique teaching to the field of conflict resolution, negotiations, and diplomacy. And that is that it consistently over-focuses on dialogue and the word and not enough on relationship and the doing. Because so much of what we're talking about here is how what you do defines you. You know, what Jimmy has done that defines him, the building of the house, the gesture on the plane, the gesture with the pictures. I mean, it's what you showing up every week, teaching, that humility of participation. All of these things connected him in deep ways. I mean, he may not have known this, but Begin was also doing that in Jerusalem his whole life. He showed up as a very private person to various synagogues, and he would sit there and pray. And Sadat, in his own way, I mean, he became like this servant for a mission. And he was, gosh, I mean, by the time I got involved in 2000 and I was with the Mubaraks and with others in
in these processes with Arafat and others. And, we're being recorded, but there was something about Sadat that was unique in Egyptian history. A very powerful warrior, a very powerful peacemaker, incredibly engaging with human beings in the same way that Jimmy was. So these are the kind of, this is the magic that's created by these moments of transformation. And I love that expression. I'm going to remember that. And it's a good critique in a positive sense of our field of conflict resolution, that we have to remember that as much as we are in the head, it's in the heart and in the hands that transformations, take place.
Good afternoon. My name is Yvonne Jennings. I'm a doctoral graduate from the Kurtzer Center, and I also have development experience from the World Bank, where I worked for over 20 years. And currently I have a company in South Carolina. My question is more about faith and connectivity and maybe religion, because I'm from Haiti, where voodoo, it's very strong. And my husband and I, we just happened to come from South America, where we spent many years. We lived there, where Pachamama is very strong. And you have also Santeria in the Caribbean. When you work, the work I'm doing, how do I deal with that? Because this is something that I shy away from. Because I was a Catholic, now I'm Anglican. And I do not know how to deal with those invisible religions, those invisible faith that are really very present in many countries that need to be developed. How do you deal with that? Thank you.
I want to open it up to the panel, but I have some things to say too. So I don't want to be...
You're the expert on that, Mark.
Yeah, I know, but I mean, I know I've had many students of alternative religions, but I don't want to usurp here. So, Catherine, has this come up in your global work? You know, what are your feelings about that? And then I can pipe into.
What comes to my mind immediately is being at a large interreligious meeting in around the year 2000. There was the Millennium Summit.
Yeah.
And at one point, they had the most remarkable collection of people from indigenous communities all on the stage. And they looked out at the religious leaders and they said, "When you got through with us, we're what's left."
Mm.
And I was speaking about that recently with a Canadian grandmother who, what was interesting in that was her sense of a powerful, common, deep belief that's held across the huge diversity of indigenous communities, that they find ways to find common ground on very fundamental issues. And some of it is, in a sense, the essence of humanity. It's the caring about each other, the sense of the life cycle. But obviously that's a very complex question, but I will end with just one thing that I'm meeting constantly, even in meetings this morning. I started at 3:00 because there's a meeting in Berlin going on that I needed to be tuning into. But in this question about religion and how... It's very easy to make the argument that religion is critically important. We use the figure 84% of the world's population has a religious affiliation. But the question that comes after, and this is the World Bank, but many other people as well, is what do I do with that? How do I take that insight and this hugely complex world that's, as Mark said in the beginning, both very political, but also extremely personal. And how do I translate that into the host of issues that we face?
I mean, for those of us who are in this work for a lifetime, I mean, Jerry oversaw a very large diversity of religions in the metropolitan Washington area. It was a given that everybody was at the table.
Parliament of World Religions began this process over 120 years ago in the 1880s already. And we've evolved since then to a great many multinational, multi-religious organizations around the world. And so it's a given of civility. But that doesn't answer the deeper question you have about how to relate. And my bias is towards practice, ritual, and ethics, where there is commonality, and especially studying this around the world. It's not lost on me. I mean, I fell in love with the Gandhi family when I in the 1990s already, and I ended up through Gandhi's grandchildren. I ended up going to Panchgani in 1996 for the 50th anniversary of Gandhi's passing, and I remember completely dazed and sick in Mumbai, coming off of the plane with my dear friend Brian Hamlin. Was my partner in peace building, a Christian partner. And we didn't know what we were doing. We just knew that we wanted to get to know what was happening. And we ended up going down this alleyway, and everybody was surrounding something, looking like there was something wrong in this pit. And so we kept on trying to go around and look at what was inside. And then I grew up very Orthodox religious. And I'm not allowed to do any rituals of any other religions at all. But I just talk and I relate to people on an ethical level. And it turns out we were doing a ritual. It was a worship service for a certain god in India. Because that was the ritual. It was walking around. It's called a puja. And later on I read it. So, oh my God, I did a ritual. But that kind of, that introduced me to the world of India, where it turns out that the news and political religion and the weaponization of religion would have you believe that this is a perpetual war between Islam and Hinduism. But in the reality of India, beyond that, there are hundreds of villages where Hindus and Muslims quietly share each other's rituals, despite a monotheistic faith and a polytheistic faith. Because in lived religion, it's different. And so we are interested in peace building in lived reality, not in theoretical dogma. And so we go right past that. And so do a lot of extraordinary spiritual people. You just don't, you know, it's what you do that defines you. And when you find what they do, my students from all of the religions that you mentioned, I've had students from all of them, it's what they do. And it's where they find the commonalities in peace building, which is where to build. And there's a lot to build. Reverend.
Thank you. I have to confess, I'm a Baptist. That joke that was told about St. Peter guiding someone around heaven and telling them to be quiet when we pass the Baptist because they think they're the only ones here, there's a truth to that. But one of the things I've come to see, and I've appreciated being in interfaith space recently, and one of the things I'm beginning to ponder is, if God speaks to all of us and we hear God in particularized cultural and distinctive ways that we might be able to hear God, and that the responsibility of those of us who are in faith traditions and celebrate your faith tradition, be in it, delve into it deeply, is to begin to be sensitive to what it is that God, however God might be conceived, is saying through other religions. This is the same thing that God has said to me and to the people in my tradition. And then also to ask the question, what is the need that this religion seems to be meeting for the people who are adherents? What are they hearing in Santeria and Obia? And what is it that they are receiving that they need as part of their life? And how might I learn about the numinous that I can't conceive, conceptualize, or contain within my own tradition? What might I learn about the numinous from them as well? So I think there's a certain reverence with which we approach those that differ. And again, your story about Jimmy Carter brings that to the forefront.
Yeah. I have to tell you, this fellow, we've been together through the pandemic online, trying to heal
the wounds of the American universe that we live in right now with a lot of other people. And I have never had somebody convince me to pray more in my entire life. I mean, every time it's just like, there's no barriers, there's no boundaries. And it's like, Mark, will you lead us in prayer now? I'm a doer. But it's a, you know, it's been inspiring, and I think I'm starting to understand more and more the tradition you come from, where why that's so important, and how it's such a liberating aspect of the peace and the human rights and the love of humanity that that Jimmy Carter and Rosalynn Carter have expressed in their lifetime.
Well, on that question, I wanted to raise the. The concept, Christopher Sendel's concept of holy envy, that there is something to learn from every faith, and the deeper you go into it, the more you see something that can increase your own faith or give a new perspective to your own faith. That's on the personal level. I mean, but I also think what you said from the very beginning, that the script that Jimmy Carter's insight that people other than celibates that may still be grandchildren, I mean, pictures of family, what we have in common with folks, whether it's Santeria or voodoo practice, there is to go to the place that we have something in common is the place to begin, and in this case end also.
So I want to I please thank these extraordinary Peacemakers.
Could I ask the first one?
Yeah.
Could I ask a special favor? Could we hear the prayer of the mothers?
Oh. This is the prayer of the mothers that Rabbi Serrata mentioned of the Palestinian and Israeli mothers.
Yeah, the Palestinian woman who lives in the Galilee area is Shecha Ibtisam Mohammed, the Israeli religious leader, Rabbi Tamar Elad Applebaum. God of life, you who heals the brokenhearted, binding up our wounds, please hear this prayer of mothers. You did not create us to kill each other, nor to live in fear or rage or hatred in your world. You created us so that we allow each other to sustain your name in this world. Your name is life. Your name is peace. For these I weep. My eye sheds water. For our children crying in the night, for parents holding infants, despair and darkness in their hearts, for a gate that is closing, who will rise to open it before the day is gone? With my tears and with my constant prayers, with the tears of all women deeply pained at these harsh times, I raise my hands to you in supplication. Please, God, have mercy on us. Hear our voice that we not despair, that we will witness life with each other, that we have mercy one for another, that we share sorrow with one another, that we hope together one for another. Inscribe our lives in the book of life. For your sake, our God of life, let us choose life. For you are peace, your word, your world is peace, and all that is yours is peace. May this be your will. And let us say amen. Amen.